Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us here at Elm Grove Baptist Church. Whether you're sitting out in the pews or you are out in internet land. My phone just freaked out. And, we want to welcome you, and we ask a special request to those that's in the internet world that you share, like, and leave a comment. And that way we can maybe get in contact with you too. I forgot my train of thought. Just go on. I heard a good joke this week. It said there was a stone in the cemetery, and the epitaph wrote on the stone was this: "Remember, man, as you walk by, as you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so shall you be. Remember this and follow me." And someone took a spray can and wrote underneath that and said, "To follow you, I'll not consent until I know which way you went." All right, tonight at 6:30 is our prayer meeting. August 28th at 6 p.m. is movie night at Pike County Christian School. September 4th through 9th is the Mid-America Crusade. Schedules in your bulletins. September 13th through the 15th at 7 p.m. is a nightly revival at Frankfort Baptist Church. September 16th at 6:30 p.m. is the SRBA annual worship service, and that's at the First Baptist Church in Louisiana. September 19th at 9 a.m. is the SRBA annual meeting at the Family Resource Center. The WOM is collecting Christmas in August school supplies. Noisy offering at Missouri Baptist Children's Home is going to the Missouri Baptist Children's Home, and the shoebox items is clothing items. And we have a greetings. Thank you for your gift. Your generous gift over the last 15 years means much to us. With numbers of COVID-19 cases growing in the state, our local state correctional centers remain closed to visitors. We recognize the stress this must add to the lives of offenders and their families. We shall be ready to host guests within a week of the facilities opening up to the visitors. Thank you for your part in providing the guest house. You are appreciated. In his service, Janet Heim is from the Agape House of Vandalia. Okay. Is there any other announcements?
I'd just like to say thank you to those that came Monday night to the Christmas in August, and we have a nice turnout of giving the gifts for the Salt River School. Christian school. And you can still bring it until next Sunday, and then Julie and I are going to take the things over to the school because they are starting early, I think.
Okay. Any other announcements? How about birthdays, anniversaries? Let's go to noisy offering.
I also want to thank everybody for their thoughts for and prayers for Randy and Nola. Decisions, decisions.
TikTok.
All right, that's all I have.
So as we get ready to pray, two things I want you to be thinking about. We don't need to make a decision right now. Two things to think about is the crusade is in 2 weeks. You know, we've been talking about it for some time now, but now it's almost upon us. So and this church has not yet given anything towards that. But so be thinking about that. And you know, first off, do we think that that's something that we should invest in? And secondly, what amount do we feel led by the Lord to do so? And then secondly is the Lord's Supper will be next week. So if there's anybody that thinks that they might have time to go ahead and get that set up.
I have the box out of that Kathy brought. She brought a new box of crackers and things like that. So I have all that set in there with the stuff where Wanda said that they would do it one at a time.
Oh, well, there we go. All right. Don't you love it when you think something needs to be taken care of and you find out, yeah, it's already done? That's awesome. So, speaking of things that are already done, as we go, we're going to go into a time of prayer. And the reason, in my mind, that they're already linked is because some of the things that have been put on your heart that we're going to be praying about, God's already said. You know, you come to me with a faithful heart. You ask for me to speak to you, and I'm going to speak to you. It's not really even a question. It's an if then. If you come to me with an open heart, I will speak to you. So with that in mind, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, that we can come to a place of worship like this. We thank you, Father, that you pulled upon these hearts here to be here. We pray, Father, that you be with our brothers and sisters that are either concerned about the virus or being extra cautious today, and we appreciate that. And Father, we know that's not a condition that's unique with our church. Many churches this morning, even within our own association, are not open this morning, Father, because of whether it be concerns or whether those concerns are just precautionary or whether they're they need to because there's some actual incidents there. Father, we just pray that you would be with them. That we ask, Father, that you be with this service here. That you would use everything in this service, Father, for its intent, which is to lift you. We lift our voices to you. We lift our hearts to you. And we just ask, Father, that you would bless those in attendance and those that might be listening online throughout the course of today or this week, that they may be lifted up as well, and that they may grow closer to you as a result of spending time here this morning with us. But we offer this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
For those of you who were here when we started our Sunday school hour this morning, I requested prayer especially today and at this time, and Arlene just did a minute ago for Randy McDonald's family. Randy being a personal friend of mine, I know that at this hour Randy is in the pulpit at his church of his own choice because they had relieved him of the duty temporarily for what has happened, and he said no, I'm compelled to take my place in the pulpit this morning. In fact, he told me earlier in the week what he was talking about today. So struggles that we go through just sometimes points out how God uses us and how much he can strengthen us in times of need. So please remember Randy and his family continually, especially during this hour this morning when he's speaking from the pulpit. Let's worship together by turning to 373. Rise up, O men of God. Let's stand as we sing and remain standing for prayer. 373. Lift high the cross of Christ, tread where his feet have trod, as brothers of the Son of Man, rise up, O men of God, rise up, O men of God. Tom has our prayer this morning.
Our kind, gracious Heavenly Father, we are thankful for a God who hears and answers our prayers. Though we don't always like the way they're answered, they are all answered. We pray that we know and that we can learn and know the will of God and act on what we know. So I pray for the ones who are in sorrow and need healing, that those prayers may be answered. We pray this in thy name.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. You can be seated. Thank you, Tommy. Turn to 55. Page 55, glorious things of thee are spoken. We may need just a little more volume on this one, Tony. We'll see. 55.
Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion City. Salvation's walls surrounded. See the streams of living waters springing from eternal love. Well, supply thy sons and daughters, and no fear of want removed. Who can faint while such a river ever does that thirsts assuage? Grace which like the Lord the giver never goes from age to age.
To the option. His name is wonderful. We'll stand on the last verse and the ushers prepare, please. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. He is the wonderful Jesus, my Lord. The rock of all ages, Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus. Bow
the sick and the homeless. Bless all the churches. Bless each and every member. Bless those that are traveling and working. Lord, bless the message and the offering. We pray and ask in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Beautiful melody that makes it easy for us to turn our thoughts to how grateful we should be for the blessings He gives us. We have a number of people are out today for various reasons. It's my understanding that Gene and Julia's daughter Julie has contracted the virus and is tested positive, and she spent the entire day on Wednesday with them, taking them to the doctor and so forth, which made them this is the wrong time for them to mix, so they stayed home for safety reasons, for our safety reasons as well as theirs, and then others followed suit that had been with them. So, and then we have several that are away traveling and so forth. So let's be mindful of those that are away, those that are concerned. Let's not be living in fear because of this thing, but I think it's good that we are cautious and just remember, as Bill said in his prayer, God's in charge and he will direct where this thing is supposed to go. Let's turn to 283, redeemed. 283. Redeemed. Can tell. I know that
The light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, his child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. Love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, his child and forever I am.
Pastor.
That was a pretty song.
Very pretty.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Billy, I feel the need to tell you, Vicki is watching, so watch what you say. Good to have you all here this morning. So I was watching the news this week. I don't know about you all, but I'm starting to talk myself out of doing that. It's kind of depressing, but I was watching the news this week, and I'm watching the news, and in particular, I'm watching their reactions to the Democratic National Convention. Now, even though I'm going to mention the Democratic National Convention, what I'm here to talk about actually has nothing to do with that, but just people in general. Because you see, as I'm watching that, I want to ask you, there was something I noticed, and I want to know if anybody else saw this. And it doesn't matter what side of the political aisle you're on, because they're both doing it. Well, what they would do is they would discuss something that the other side did or didn't do. And then they would discuss what the real motives were for why that person did or didn't do that. Anybody else notice that? You know, it's like, I can't think of, right off the top of my head, of a good example, but they would mention that, maybe the president was going to do such a thing, and the real reason he's doing that is because he's trying to shut down the post office so that, you know, voting by mail isn't possible. You know, well, of course you have to ignore the total fact that he's given $60 million to the post office, you know, in order to make that claim. But again, this isn't political. This is about that part where they point out something and then they give the motives. Anybody? So I saw some nodding heads, so other people saw that. So what, and the reason that that kind of bothers me a little bit is because I am very much aware that no human being really knows the heart of another human being. That is an ability that rests solely with the creator of that human being, God. So as I was studying that subject as to, you know, why that is, I kind of went on a little rabbit trail, because one of my sources had a very intriguing thing that they had looked at. The gentleman is Greg Bitter. He's a pastor in Hancock, Minnesota. So I kind of want to give a nod out to him this morning. But in my study of the heart of man, it occurred to me, and correct me if I'm wrong or if someone online knows that I'm wrong, but it occurred to me that there's actually only one man that actually came right out and said,
test my heart. That actually threw the gauntlet down and said, God, try my heart. And that, of course, was King David. So today, we're going to take a look. We're going to take a look at the second king of Israel, King David, and specifically compare him to the first king of Israel, Saul. So just for those of you who might need a point of reference, we're going to be in 1 Samuel 16, 1 through 13. But this gauntlet that I'm talking about is found in Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24, when Samuel said, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Now I'll tell you a reason that I really, really like that. Because I don't have to be God to know that David wasn't perfect. I mean, it's very obvious that David wasn't perfect, because we read later on of some stuff he did that was very unperfect. But God, David knows that God already knows his heart, just as he knows the heart of all his created being. And he offers up his heart for examination. That is quite a testament of faith. I don't know, I wouldn't do that. I mean, I've had days where at the end of the day, I look at myself in the mirror and I'm not real impressed with the man I see there. So I certainly wouldn't offer my heart up for examination to God. But in 1 Samuel 16, 1 through 13, we find the prophet Samuel, and he is being introduced to David. So, you know, obviously David's not king yet. David's actually just a small boy, but he's being introduced to David. And so if you would join with me, we're going to be looking at 1 Samuel 16, 1 through 13. "And the Lord said unto Samuel, How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil, and go. I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite," I'm going to butcher this, "for I have provided me a king among his sons. And Samuel said, How can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, Take a heifer with thee, and say, I am come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show thee what thou shalt do. And thou shalt anoint unto me him whom I name unto thee. And Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, Comest thou peaceably? And he said, Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourselves, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. And it came to pass, when they were come, that he looked on Eliab, and he said, Surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, Look not on his countenance, or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab, and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, Neither hath the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by. And he said, Neither hath the Lord chosen this. Again Jesse made seven of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, The Lord hath not chosen these. And Samuel said unto Jesse, Are here all thy children? And he said, There remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, Send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him. Now he was ruddy, and withal of a beautiful countenance, and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, Arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil, and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. So this story, I don't know, I kind of find this fascinating. Imagine being one of those other seven. You know, apparently they're all good-looking young men. I mean, the very first one that Samuel met, he was pretty sure this is the guy. Tall, rugged, good-looking, he's the guy. Well, it says, no, it's not him. And he goes through the line, one at a time. I had brothers and sisters. I was the oldest. That is quite a mantle to carry. Well, imagine being the youngest and having a prophet of God who works directly with the king come and tell you you're going to be the next king. Well, this is real problematic because the king's still alive. The first king's still there. But we read God's response to Samuel, "The Lord looketh on the heart." It's still a term we use today, knowing the heart of someone, what's in their heart. And it refers to the combination of mind and emotions, a combination of a person's character, their inward drive. One could say that it refers to the most inward part of you, that some don't even realize what that is until it's put to the test. That's the you that the Lord sees. See, we can put on appearances. We can play to the eyes of others. We can fool them for better or for worse. But the Lord sees the heart. He knows the real you. He knows your heart. And that's what we want to think about this morning, is the Holy Spirit leads us to reflect on the lives of both Saul and King David. So when we first started, first verse there in this chapter, God tells Samuel not to mourn for Saul. So just to give a little history as to what that was all about, as I already said, Saul isn't dead. He's still alive. He's still the king. But God has told Samuel that he's going to replace him as the king of Israel. Samuel has already told Saul this, that God is going to replace you. So what we're reading here is Samuel being sent out to find Saul's successor. And then, now in chapter 15, Samuel had shared with Saul that God was not going to allow him to remain king. And Samuel ended that conversation by making the comment that this is the last time I will see you. Which was true. For the rest of Saul's reign, Samuel never again appeared before him. So let's take a look at King Saul. You know, he started out as a good king. He was humble. He was friendly. He was obedient to what needed to be done. You might even recall the story of Saul before he became king. He was actually he was working for his father. Him and a servant went to find a donkey that had wandered off, and they couldn't figure out where it was. And they went to this prophet to see if he might help them find their donkey. They referred to him as a seer. Samuel anointed Saul to be the first king of Israel. And when Samuel called the people together to announce Saul as the king and looked around so that he could point out Saul and, you know, say, "This is your new king," you all might remember the story. He couldn't find him. It's like, They have to go search for him. And he's hiding. He's hiding behind some baggage. Because he realized he was not fit to lead the Lord's people. There were some troublemakers in the group who despised him, made it very clear. I mean, they vocalized that they thought he would make a horrible king. But Saul said nothing. So the town of Jabesh-Gilead becomes under attack. And they send word that they need their fellow Israelites to come to their aid, to save them. So Saul rallies together Israel, forms an army, and they go and save them. Monumental victory. And when they came back and were celebrating their victory, there was amongst the celebrants those that remembered these troublemakers. And so they started crying out, "Kill them. Take the troublemakers, kill them. This guy is obviously meant to be our king. Kill his foes." In 1 Samuel 11:13, we have Saul's response. He says, "No one shall be put to death today, for this day the Lord has rescued Israel." That's pretty great, isn't it? The people recognize you as the king, which means you have the authority to simply glance at someone the wrong way and they're put to death. And he says, "No. These people spoke badly of me, but this is the Lord's day. We are here celebrating the Lord's defeat, or the Lord's defeat of his enemy. We're not going to kill anybody." So he was off to a really good start. But something happened. Something happened between then and when we're reading, where God is telling Samuel it's too late for him. We need to find his successor. There had actually been many incidents. It wasn't as if Saul did one thing and God said, "You're done." He had actually done many things. But the breaking point, if you will, was Samuel told Saul that him and the army were to go into the camp of the Amalekites and totally destroy it. It was marked for destruction, which meant nothing. Not a single thing was to live. Now to us, that might seem a little cold, a little hard-hearted of God to think like that. But he had his reasons. But so they go in there and they do win the battle. And they kill everybody. But him and his men kept the sheep and the cattle. As a matter of fact, one of the best lines in the Bible is when Saul is coming back and Samuel meets him, and Samuel says, "Did you do what God said to do?" And Samuel says, "Yep, did exactly what you said to do." He says, "Exactly what God said to do?" "Yep, exactly what God said to do." Samuel says, "So why do I hear the neighing and bleating of animals?" And Saul says, "Oh, well, okay, yeah, that we didn't do. We didn't kill all the animals like you said to kill. The men thought we should bring some of them back. But those are all the best of the animals. We're actually going to have a big party and offer those to God as a sacrifice." Think about that. Because that doesn't sound, I mean, to me, when I first read it, I think, well, what's wrong with that? That doesn't sound so bad. but it's not what God told him to do. He listened to his men instead of listening to God. He listened to what, boy, this is going to look pretty impressive to all the people when I have this big fire and consecrate all these animals, as opposed to God, who said, just walk in humbly and tell everyone the job is done. This is much more impressive. But it wasn't what God wanted him to do. God was not interested in the outward sacrifices. Samuel told this to Saul. And that was the, if you would, the final nail in the coffin. Saul is more willing to listen to his men than to God. Samuel started to walk away from Saul right then. He told them, you've been found unfit. God is going to remove you as king. And he started to walk away. And Saul stopped him. And Saul apologized and asked for forgiveness. But here's the key. He didn't ask for forgiveness because he was sorry. He asked for forgiveness because they were about to go back to the regular part of the army. And it was going to look really bad if the king did not have his prophet with him. So again, Saul is looking at the outward appearance. How is this going to look? So he pleads with Samuel to go with him. And Samuel does. Reiterating again, this doesn't change anything. God has rejected you as his king. But Saul started off good. And then something went wrong. And this is actually a good warning for us, even now. Because many of us have started off good. We've been baptized in Christ. We have confessed our sins and made a confession of faith. We study the Bible. And of course, we're worshiping God today. Whether it's here or whether it's online, we're spending time worshiping God. But you know what? The Lord still knows the heart. And he's not fooled by the outward appearance. So as we look at our inner selves, our thoughts, our attitudes, our emotions, our will, our motive, our drive, all of those combine into the word we call heart. We need to ask ourselves, are we an I Christian, and by me, E-Y-E, I Christian, because we're concerned about what looks good to others, or are we driven by what's in our hearts? Do we go through the motions of being a Christian, typically called a Sunday Christian? Are you doing it? Are you here today because you're supposed to? Because if you're not here, someone's going to ask why you're not here. Are you here because that's what your parents did? Makes you look good? You know, there are some businessmen, not here, there are some businessmen that attend church because that's a great place to make contacts. Are you trying to find that balance between what makes you look like a good Christian but you don't want to come off as being a religious fanatic? I mean, the Bible can be taken too far, right? Surely you're not supposed to witness to everybody. some Christians find it, you know what, it is just too hard. It is just too hard to follow what God wants us to do. So I'm going to do this instead. Because God says he'll forgive me, I'm going to go ahead and do what I want, and I'll just ask forgiveness. Kind of like some kind of get out of jail card. Maybe there's some people here, and I don't mean here sitting in these pews necessarily, but maybe watching or will watch someday. But you're thinking to yourself, you know what? That's not me. He's not talking about me because I always follow Jesus with my whole heart. Yikes. You just proved my point. Because you're only looking at appearances. You have fooled yourself. And again, the Lord is not fooled by outward appearances. And you know why I say that even if you do believe that you're following Jesus with your whole heart, you know what's the problem with that? Your heart is divided. Your heart is divided just like mine, just like Saul's. The only way your heart is not divided is if you've actually already given up on God and you're now leaning totally the other way. The new self in you and me delights in the Word of God, rejoices in His love, and desires to do His will. But the old self is still there. And that old self, it betrays me. I may be reading my Bible, fall asleep. I may be listening to a sermon and start yawning. I may realize that I need to go to a revival or a crusade or some other event. Just like the teenager, it's like, ugh. I've got a long day at work. Really? Got to go sing hymns? Yeah. The old self is still there. But what do we do about it? Well, just like we're not very much different from Saul, we're also not very much different from David. The last part of our reading said that from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power. The very next chapter is when he is going to slay a man that is over 9 foot tall, whose sword David can't even lift. The Holy Spirit changes us. It changes us to the core. In that fight between David and Goliath, David, a kid. You remember, Saul wanted him to put on Saul's armor, which is a great compliment. You know, it's a great honor. The king is going to let you wear his armor. You should be impressed. But it doesn't fit him. He can't walk around in this thing. So he says, no, that's okay. Just give me my slingshot, 5 stones, and I'm good. And when he steps out there, and Goliath starts to mock him, I asked for a warrior. You're sending me a boy. Maybe you recall David's response. We find it in 1 Samuel. He says, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Ooh. Makes my hair go up. If I was David, I'd be a little nervous. I was Goliath, I'd be a little nervous. But what it tells us is David trusted in the Lord. Have you ever asked yourself, well, I'm getting on a rabbit trail, I apologize, why five stones? There's only one guy, and we know he only used one stone, but he picked up five. Tradition says that Goliath had four brothers. David was ready. They don't keep their promise, that's okay. I'm ready for them too. Saul, of course, was still alive. He started to realize what was going on. He hunted David down for the purpose of killing him. On two occasions, David had Saul trapped. One of them was, you might remember, Saul went in to relieve himself in the cave. David and his men are in the cave. His men are saying, take your shot. There he is. He doesn't do it. He walks up on Saul asleep. The king is asleep. David just tears off a piece of his cloak and feels guilty about it. But he uses it to show Saul, I had my chance. I could have killed you, and I didn't. So stop thinking I'm trying to kill you. But he felt bad about tearing the garment. But David wasn't perfect. Even though he had the Lord's anointing on him, he still committed adultery. He still had one of his 30 bravest soldiers killed. But David also admitted, I have sinned against the Lord. He knew when he'd done wrong. Prophet Nathan told him, the Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die. That sounds like good news, doesn't it? Kind of was. What Nathan didn't tell him at the time was, the son born out of your adultery is going to die. This book, the Bible, holds a lot of promises in it. John tells us, the words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. The Holy Spirit uses our minds to help us understand His words, to understand His promises, and in saying so, gives us that faith that we need to believe. Because without the Holy Spirit, His words would seem like foolishness. And you see that, don't you? Watch people who are not Christians. What do they say about Christians? They're foolish, unlearned, just don't know the way that the world is these days. And Christians stare at them, at these people who are so immersed in sin, they don't even know it, with the question on our mind, how do you explain to a fish that it's wet? It's all it knows. So in order to be bathed in the Spirit, we need to use His Word. If we want to be like David, not like Saul, we use His Word. A good place to start is the book of Psalms. Songs of praise, written mostly by David. Because we have the ability to do so much more than simply have that outward facade of a Christian. We can do a real work, but only through Christ. And that inner you, our thought, our mind, our emotions, our attitude, our will, our drive, all those things that make up our heart are turned to Him. He knows how to keep you. And He will not fail. So as we have our hymn of invitation, I ask you, just as David asked God, search your heart. And if you find it lacking, you're encouraged to come forward.
Another one of those coincidences, turn to 591. Pure in heart, O God. 591. Let's stand as we sing.
I do want to remind everybody about the crusade. I think in your bulletin today you had a flyer that actually the same thing. So I encourage you to hold on to that as the day gets closer and people ask you if you know anything about the crusade. Have that handy. Have it on your which day where. Keep that handy so you can answer that question. They really tried this year to do something different. Because normally they don't do that. They try to have it at one location because as it is, they're going to have to break down and put up again at a new location every single day. Certainly be easier if they were just at one place. But this gives them the opportunity to touch more people. So please pray for that as it goes on. And is there, our prayer meeting is tonight, so ask all of you that can be a part of that. Is there any other items of business that I have overlooked? Yes, Kat.
I don't have an item of business, but when I went and got my shot on the 19th, I had a great improvement, and so he stretched it from going every month. Now I go in 6 weeks, and found out one of the doctors up there come to Mexico once a month, so we won't have to drive to Colombia every time I have the shot.
Oh, it was a double blessing, wasn't it?
Oh, I told him, I said, I praise God and I thank you.
Didn't they say you had 20/20 vision?
In my right eye, yeah.
That's awesome. Kathy?
I just want to remind everyone that the new quarterly books for next quarter, Sunday school books, are on the front pew.
Yep. Yeah, we'll need those in 2 weeks, so you might want to grab one. Any other items? All right. Tony, could I ask you to give our closing prayer?
Lord, we just thank you for the ability to come together and worship you, that we live in the country that allows us to do that. And just be with us. And